Campaign finance disclosure is an essential public accountability mechanism, and the lack of access to such information can make for a skeptical voter. Our next guest says following the money is critical to informed decision making, especially at a local level. Joining me to discuss this and more, we welcome Daniella Levine Cava, Miami-Dade County Commissioner for District 8. Commissioner, 1 year in office, congratulations to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ellen.
You wrote a really interesting op-ed in the November 30th edition of the Miami Herald titled, "We Need to Know Who Gives and Who Takes Political Cash." The idea of having political action committees known as PACs is not new. It has been guaranteed by the Supreme Court as a First Amendment issue. But you are proposing legislation for a local level use of PACs. Why?
Transparency and accountability. People need to know where is this money coming from, so there's disclosure. It's a simple matter of information for the public to help to restore trust.
Are there instances that you can say, not necessarily in this last year, although it could be in the last year, but other times would you say there are certain key issues where voters might have made different decisions had they know where the money for campaign issues, because it could be for a campaign issue, not specifically for a politician, would have made a difference?
I think for one thing, it just helps them to feel that it's not hidden, that things are out in the open, that they can make informed decisions. So maybe it's not the specific, it's the general idea that when people are contributing to campaigns or to the political committees that support campaigns, that the public has a right to know where is that money coming from.
And so you're not saying it's wrong to do so, it's just let's see who's who.
Exactly right.
So what would your proposed legislation require?
It is a first step. It would require disclosure for any candidate or elected officer whose position is coming up for vote to disclose that they are associated with a political committee and any solicitations that they do receive.
Now, somebody would say to you, but as a we are not allowed to say, for example, a political candidate can't be part of a political committee, correct?
Well, not actually. Political committees can support the work of a campaign, and there's an independent chairman of that, but the candidate could very well let people know about that source of funding for the campaign and solicit.
So when you speak on this issue, what do you hear from your colleagues? I mean, not everybody's going to like it. They're not going to say so, but they may not like it.
First, I've received the very positive response from the public and also fortunately from my colleagues. The majority did approve the ordinance going forward on first reading, and I've heard tremendous support from the public during my campaign, since I've been in office, and once I filed this legislation. So I'm feeling very confident that we will have this small change made and that this will increase disclosure and therefore public trust. Not only trust, Helen, but participation. When people feel better about the political process, then they're more likely to engage in the political process.
And it seems ironic that you would think that when you feel better about something, you engage less because you trust. But here we have just the opposite, that people don't trust, and so instead of being active and participating in making the change, people don't.
Yes, they think the system is rigged. They think that they have no voice. And this small matter of just being so cynical about how campaigns are financed really turns people off to voting and to participating civically.
And there are something, you know, we were speaking before going on the air, and there were a couple of issues that have really galvanized voters in unique ways in the local community that's woken them up to participate. And one caught many by surprise, many elected officials by surprise, which was the issue of library and library funding.
Yes.
And of course, the idea of stadium and stadium, over-subsidizing stadiums. And even I have to say that I was very surprised by the by Miami-Dade County public school officials wanting to be a part of a soccer stadium so that the owners of the soccer stadium wouldn't have to pay taxes. It's just astounding to me.
Well, the public really has been burned on stadiums, as we know, and so there's not much appetite for them. But lots of other issues, sea level rise. Look at the tremendous outpouring of public will about really doing something dramatic to address our sea level rise issues. And so people want to have a government that they feel is responsive and accountable to them, and it starts with the campaign. In my own campaign, I had a difficult time with some of the PACs that were working against me. My opponent disavowed any relationship to them, and it was very difficult and in some cases impossible to know where were these campaign materials coming from, who was paying for them.
And that really makes a difference.
Yes, indeed.
Because you know who the interests are behind those that are supporting a candidate.
Exactly right. And then again, that just helps the public, and not everybody is going to go down to that level, but we count on an informed, engaged media to tell us these things as well. And so we need that information.
When you look at this first year in office, what are the takeaways that you say from the learning curve is always going to be high for somebody who really tries to do the job right and to work it hard. What's the takeaway from you with this first year?
We've worked hard to engage the community. I have always been on the community side of government, and I've always tried to make government more responsive from my vantage point outside of government. And I've continued that commitment inside government. We've communicated and over-communicated, let people know what we're working on, asked for input. We had a very successful initiative around funding for our parks, which had been, along with the libraries, really cut off at the knees, and we were successful with the public's active engagement in increasing substantially parks funding this past year.
There's a lot that Miami-Dade County could do better if it had perhaps a little bit more funding coming from the state legislature on certain issues. If you had a wish list, what would be on the top two?
Transportation and water.
Water in what way?
We need water to flow through our Everglades. We need it not only to...
Everglades restoration.
We need Everglades restoration. We need it not only for the Everglades, the health of the Everglades, but for our own fresh water supply. We need it as a hedge against sea level rise and saltwater intrusion. We need fresh water to come south from the lake and flow into a healthy Everglades.
Okay, so we look at that very quickly in 1 minute. We have transportation as such a critical issue.
Absolutely.
In what way would we benefit from the legislature taking an active voice in this? And what do you favor? Because there's no one right answer to transportation. We did a special on issues reports a couple of months ago on this specific issue, and it's very complicated.
Yeah, well, there is a joke going around that any meeting of the county commission turns into a meeting on transportation, and that is definitely the case. And there are now a lot of good proposals on the table, and we do need some state funding along with federal
funding. Is there anything, any proposal that you are particularly, what are the key proposals that you look at that you say, these are the most serious ones and the most doable ones?
Yes.
Forget Tallahassee, that you can see.
Yes.
I was very surprised to see that the transportation, that the Citizens Transportation Fund is taking away over a period of time, 4 to 5 years, funding for buses, because the promise was originally new monies for new projects, and funding the operations of buses wasn't included. So that's a wake-up call to make a right change.
We have some very strong proposals to do bus rapid transit on a number of the key corridors. That is bus, it's a bus that runs like a train. Mm-hmm. So it has a dedicated lane, it has signal prioritization, people load at the same level as they stay and they pay in advance. These things cut down dramatically on transit time and make transit a real option of choice for people. Those are the kinds of solutions we need.
And you also are going to need to have somebody, some type of the first mile and the last mile
exactly.
of the journey are critical.
Absolutely.
And that's got to be found. That's got to be covered one way or another. Again, are you in favor of Uber being legalized?
I think Uber is going to
Uber
be coming.
And Lyft.
And Lyft.
I don't want to say
and
just
so
Uber.
On. I think we have to come up with a solution that will preserve our options and not give unfavorable advantages to one side or the other.
Daniella Levine, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Joining us today on Issues. Hope to have you back soon.
Thank you.